CNBC TV 18 Weekender.
Hello and welcome to CNBC TV 18 The Weekender. I'm Manisha Gupta. Joining us today on the show is a fashion designer who's also a philanthropist. She has a lot of achievements under her belt, has been awarded for various works of hers. She also has done jewelry and theater. She has dressed a lot of celebs and has had greater achievements in various ways. She also works very closely to causes that are close to her heart. Joining us on the show is Mahika Mirpuri. Mahika, hi. It's such a pleasure to be here at your beautiful home. First of all, tell us on what do you think India stands on in sense of fashion map?
India as a fashion market is extremely growing, as you know. I think it's grown over leaps and beyonds. There was a time 20 years back when I started my career. I was just about 19, 20 at that time. There were a handful of designers in our country. And today we're inundated with it. It's everywhere. It's so common. So it's a growing market. And there's a lot of exposure. Today we're inundated with it. It's everywhere. It's so common. So it's a growing market. And there's a lot of exposure, there's a lot of awareness, and I would say it's one of the best places to invest in. So it's highly fashion conscious.
So when you look at the supply and demand, where would you put the balance at?
I would say as a percentage wise, it's would be like what, 60-40. The bridal market in India is highly where we stand, and I would say that would be our strata. Because the Western market is influenced by the high street international brands that have made their foray into India. So the designer market where we come into is more for quality, and therefore the bridal acumen is what stands for us.
Every new day you have yet another brand launching its stores in India, in various cities as well. Do you see that as a competition when it comes to designers?
We've got high street Western international brands coming into India, and they've all made their foray. But we yet don't have a Valentino or a Galliano. And having said that, the designers can't compete with this level because there's this quantity and their numbers speak. Whereas we do quality, and it's more like for occasion-based stuff or couture or bridal market. So it's really not competitive because it's a different line altogether. They work on volumes and we work on quality.
So you're saying when it comes to designing clothes in India, it's got to do more about the Indian ethics and the culture here, not so much when it comes to Western?
India today is a huge market, and they're opening several brands, and it's like growing. Every mall has it. It's like signature stores. Whereas high-end designer brands, where we come into place, is basically for the bridal acumen. And I feel that's our forte. We've got occasion-based. Today, if you need a kurta, you'll come to me, not for a plain shirt. So I feel that's where the balance comes in. It is a competitive society.
So you talked to us about how you started into this when you were 19 or 21. I mean, that's a time you aren't even done with your graduation.
Basically, it was a fashion, a passion which has driven me. And I used to physically hand paint on dupattas, and I used to sell them. And I still remember how we reflect and days go by. There were clothes hung in the house, and I did my small exhibitions from home, had clients coming home. It's just grown and grown, and with time today, I just feel like it's become a full brand. 20 years back, there were really handful of designers.
Sure.
You know, people used to really look out for people, and today, our country is inundated. We've got fashion weeks, we've got every person getting married becomes a designer. There's so much going on.
But when did it become commercially viable? When did you turn into an entrepreneur with it?
I think I reached a time when I couldn't work from the house anymore, and I felt there were more clients than members in my house. It was like the whole house was taken over by my work. It started with few tailors. Today I have like a whole team of over 50-60 workers working for me.
So apart from family and friends, who were those first clients that you still have very strong memories on? And how has you know, the journey being? You've dressed some celebs as well. There are some big names attached to who all you've actually put your clothes on. So which has been a memorable moment there?
They've been all walks of life. I've got society women, I've got HNIs, I've got corporates, I've got, like you said, family, friends, a lot of people from the film industry, Pariniti, Sonakshi, Sushmita, Bipasha, Manisha, the list is endless, Vivek Oberoi. I've dressed up a lot of them. At every point of time, there has been someone who we've dressed up, and and yeah, I've been quite happy to have worked with one of the, with some of the few really good achieving names today. And it's been a pleasure.
So, the wedding season is just about approaching, and I'm assuming you're going to get just more busier as we get into it with the bridal thing. And we also did a study on where it shows that for every lakh rupees that a wedding member perhaps spends, a big chunk of that actually gets into jewelry and clothes, and you are into both of these.
So primarily as a designer, we've got two seasons, which is fall, winter and summer.
Sure.
And fall, winter is the time which is our main season because it's Diwali. And that's a huge festival for us. I mean, having said that, we've had demonetization, we've had GST, all at the same time. So I'll be lying to tell you that I wasn't affected. The whole country, the whole economy was affected. But it's stabilized and I've had a great Diwali.
So you talked about themes. What has been your favorite and how did you get inspiration for that?
This collection, which I just launched, was Can Fly. Hmm. It was on a cause. This is a charitable show which I host every year. I've had a personal loss in my family, and now for 5 years, I do a show for the Tata Memorial Hospital, which is where we raise money. It's like an auction. It's actually a fundraiser, a charity gala. Mm. And we have people who come from different walks. They add power to the evening. We've had Anil Kapoor, Randeep Hooda this time, Vivek Oberoi. They come and talk about the awareness about cancer. They help us raise money. So with time to come, I'm humbled to say that I've handed over now over 2.5 crores in the last 4 years, and this year we raised about we're nearly going to be about 75 lakhs, so it'll be about 3.5 crores I think in 5 years, and the monies go direct to Tata Memorial where they use it for the treatment of the patients. So the theme, now coming back to the theme of the collection, more than the theme, I call the whole evening Can Fly, because I believe you can fly out of the disease.
You have been attached to a lot of causes in a few years. So
MCAN is primarily my institution, which is Move for Cancer Awareness, which is with the Tata Memorial Hospital. So that's the show we do every year, so it's like 5 years now. Mm. I've done stuff for the underprivileged. I've done a show with where I had dressed up the victims of the prostitutes, so their children. So we had dressed them up, trying to give them a ray of life.
Okay, on that note, we will take a very short break, come back and continue this conversation with Mike Amirpuri.
CNBC TV 18 Weekender.
It's not just the bridal clothes or the themes that you have been working with. I mean, you've done weddings, you've done theater costumes, you've done some play costumes, etc.
Yes.
How do you reach out to all of those?
So I've done theater, I've designed jewelry, I had a jewelry contract for 2 years. Jewelry and clothes go hand in glove. So just extending your creativity to a symbol, which basically when you go for a wedding, you want a good, complete look.
So I want to come to the economics of it, but you mentioned on how demonetization, GST, that whole tax structure, the way it's changing has impacted everybody. Tided it over, as you said, but has the whole industry changed the way we stand now?
The mindset in between was a bit shuffled because it was like it's come in October, which is your prime season when people actually collect money to
spend.
And
would you say it's very cash-driven in that sense?
It was cash-driven. Yeah. I would say was because, you have to also understand the designers today cater to a 1% of the economy, which is very influential. So they are never affected because they are from the luxurious background. So if you leave that sector out, they'll buy an outfit without even an occasion. They just want to shop. So we have those kind of clients also. But having said that, there was a whole chaos all around and everybody was shuffled. But like I said, it's stabilized now. And now people are using their cards, they're spending monies. But a little bit with a conscious, okay, it's Diwali, so I'll spend. I have a wedding, so I'll spend. So if not 10 outfits, 8 outfits. But yes, I would still say when there is a wedding, India has a big fat wedding, and people do spend monies, and it is very extravagant.
So, for the longest time, you've had these big designer labels, perhaps like yourself as well, in Delhi, Mumbai, metros. But we do understand now on how so much more money and spend comes in from second-tier cities, like perhaps a Jaipur or a Ludhiana for that matter. How has the spend been or a pickup been from these cities?
I've reached a point in myself where I know now what I want, and I want to just focus on my consumer. And I want to just know, if my brand wants this, how do I get better and achieve it and get to understand the customer more? So I would like to open like stores in different metros. That's probably in the pipeline for me, that have signature stores. But selling online has made me open up to the whole globe, basically.
Sure.
Because we've tied up with FedEx, we've tied up with CC Avenue, so payments come. I mean, it's just an easier way of working. And I believe if they have access to you and if they trust you, like in my 20 years of my career, I haven't had a client who has not visited me back.
Mm.
So for me, that's my USP, because it's a very competitive society and you must be good to have them come back to you.
So, you know, I get the idea of signature stores where you go and you try 5 different dresses and you want to feel pampered and stuff.
Sure.
But this whole e-commerce thing, the way it has come, the rush, the surge of it, and of course it is being promoted by the government itself. How have you been a part of it? As you said, you are online, but when it comes to brick and mortar and the online, what are your ratios really?
See, like Amazon and these online portals are basically very price conscious because they're very like economical, right?
Hmm.
So when we talk of our online structures, the price range is yet quite high. But then you do have people in different zones who look up and they don't have a variety.
Mm.
Today when designers take their stuff, they're probably like a season old stuff and you know it's not current. So when they have access and direct avenue to get the latest stuff, it's been a huge success. And it may not be economical, but I feel for me it's been a growth.
Mm.
Because it's opened the globe for me and a wider range. When you live overseas, I mean this is for the customers who don't live within our periphery of India. Like I've got Australia, I've got UK, I've got like all over the globe literally. There are markets that they really are very, you know, like the sari and the Indian embellishments, which are so big in the West today. They look upon it as like a very high-end, you know, like it would be their red carpet garment,
mm-hmm.
more than a gown and a black suit.
But would you say that the India spend really has increased over time? Because with time, we want better quality, better range, better fabric.
It has. Like I said, there is a mind shift.
Mm.
From years to come, I'm just seeing it grow. And today I would say India is a great investment opportunity. It is very luxurious. You've got all the brands coming in. There is a spending power. There is a fashion acumen. People are aware of it. Today the consumer knows what they're paying for. It's not a foolish market.
Designing fashion, I understand, isn't really a sector recognized by the government in that way. What are the challenges, opportunities that you see when it comes to this one?
As a designer market, there should just be more opportunities because we employ staff. And today, if we get curtailed with our business, it's very difficult for us to employ because I have a lot of people. If I'm not going to do well, how will I give them salaries? And everything today is going by check and the whole shift has come.
Yeah.
So it's a circle, right? So today, if I have employment of staff and if I have to employ more staff, like we've got people from different villages, artisans, from small families, the households that are being run because of our work today, whether it's in the home or in the work field, in both structures. So I think it has to boost the luxury garment, not the garment, the luxury market, I would say.
Mm.
So it gives us more avenues to employ more staff.
Okay, on that note, we will take a very short break, come back and continue this conversation with Mayika Medpuri.
CNBC TV 18 Weekender.
You've created a lot of clothes all these years, as you said, 20. You were 20 when you started doing that. Any
right.
particular cloth or a dress or a bridal outfit that you created has been very close to you?
A lot of the painted stuff, because that's something close to my heart, because I have now taught my people how to paint. In fact, in this last collection itself, my opening piece was of a highly butterfly painted dress, and that's something close to me because I have sat days and months and done it. So I know the workmanship that goes into it. So it's a garment which I have a passion on because it was my first sale.
One person that you've loved to dress and one person you would love to dress.
Sushmita was a person I loved to dress because she has a great aura, a very strong woman, a lovely human being. I would love to dress Kate Middleton. So another person I identify with, her sense of style is classic, and I would love to dress her.
Another competitor, a designer competitor that you love designs of?
I love Rohit Pal, I love Tarun, I just love their work. And I look upon it as different and their own sense of style. So it's nice to have an industry where we're looked upon for our individuality. And we all come together and I have designers who come and, you know, say, oh, this was from you and this was from me. And I'm like, it's lovely, you need a variety. So it's great.
Mm. But where would you see the industry moving from here on? I mean, we've come a long way, as you said.
We've come a long way and I feel we'll go yet a long way because They're like, it's going global. It's like the Indian features all over the West, whether it was the sari, the Indian elements. So now you have fashion weeks even happening there. So it's like the Indian territory is everywhere.
Yeah, but Mahika, tell us, where does the funding and etc. come in from? Because not everybody starts with a pool of money.
Sure.
It isn't easy.
That's a very tough bracket, because see, overseas, you have brands investing in you. Like every luxurious brand has an investment banker or someone to franchise with you, and they therefore, you know, signify and multiply their stores. Whereas in India, designers pump in their own money, and it's tough because you put in your own brand, you put in everything, and therefore you do shop and shop and then open your signature brand. So the whole acumen is very different from the West and in India, because there you have people who come and invest in you, but that is not over here. So that could be a great shift if we have that coming in for designers. I think that would really have a big move for our.
But wouldn't that want the industry to be structured in some sense, which is not the case right now?
No, but it's like I said, it also gives you global exposure, and it also gives you more supply. And you have to understand that, like I said, Western brands have a different supply strain. Their infrastructure is different. Hmm. Whereas we designers, our couture line is limited. So it is only handful. It is not that we're doing quantity pieces. So if you have someone to invest and to franchise, I think it's viable.
As you said, you've just done a fashion week, a fashion show that is in the previous week. What is more in pipeline? What are Mahika's plans going forward from here?
Stuff what we launched at the collection was a lot with the tassels. It's a current trend going on. It's very bohemian. It's a trend to stay. Everything had tassels, from cuff collars to blouses, lots of color, because it was a Diwali oriented festive line. Mm-hmm. So we had worked on the dark the palette, and it was about I had a theme to it. It was on the butterfly, so colors of purple, blue, gray, muddy brown, earthy winter colors, our colors to see for the coming season. Kurtas and lots of velvet kotis is another thing I launched this year. That's it. It's about style, being simple and being flamboyant. Yet.
I just want to go back again to a fashion week or a fashion show. It's an industry on its own, right? From ramp walkers to light guys to music guys, etc. What is that industry now? Because
It's huge. I mean, we do it every day because it's part of our structure. Because even if it's a small show or a big show, the teamwork is that much. I mean, you need all that, like the choreography, the rehearsals, the models. I've just done it. We had like 28 models, and like I had 5 dancers flown down. So it's how you want to portray your brand, and what's the essence you want to give out? What's the message you want to give out? And in every show I do, I give out a message, because that's my personality. Because eventually it's not about just having promotional clothes. I'm very passionate about what I sell, and therefore my every collection has a theme or it has a message. And like I was sharing with you, and you take back something from an event, it's very personalized. There are giveaways, the card, everything, it all syncs. There's a theme to it, and it all connects, and there's a lot of hard work. It's taken me like 6 months to put one collection together, of just the deliverance of it. Forget the articulation of the work. It's like once you know what you want, and then you know you start working towards it, it just all dwells in. And then it's like the decor, and then you have your ramp, and then you have like a live singing. So it's how you want to escalate it, how you want to portray it. It could be that simple or that flamboyant. But there's a whole team that comes together, and there's like days of work. You have to put the things up before, like days in advance, and then you have to practice. And there's a lot of hard work to a very glamorous field.
You know, in the conversation in last half an hour, I can guess and get that you breathe, talk, sleep, dream perhaps fashion and designing. But if you weren't doing this, what would Mahika be doing as an alter ego?
Well, I'm a big yoga practitioner.
Okay.
I'm a very big gym enthusiast. So the times I get over and above my work, I'm at the gym or I'm practicing yoga, because I love to connect with my inner self. And that's another sense of me, which it gives me a lot of happiness. And I feel if the mind and the body are in connect, it just makes the mind open. And you're just in sync with yourself. You just have a more control. And it's the whole balance of life, basically. So I would see myself doing that much more.
Mahika, thank you so much for taking time out for us today.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
CNBC TV 18 Weekender.